back seat of the car seat.
The pipes you hear in these private home movies are a natural gift. Taylor's drive and her fierce determination stun everyone. At the tender age of 11, she convinced her mom to take her on a trip from their home in Pennsylvania to Nashville's famed Music Row.
I was just dead set on Nashville ever since I saw a TV special about Faith Hill. And it said that she went to Nashville.
So with this demo CD in hand, the little girl with big dreams began knocking on some of country music's biggest doors.
My mom and my little brother all went to Nashville and drove up and down Music Row. My mom would stop in front of a record label and I'd run in and hand them my CD, the receptionist, and I'd be like, "Hi, I'm Taylor, I want a record deal, if you could call me."
How did that go over?
It was sort of like, "Aw, little girl."
Oh, isn't she sweet. Did you hear back from anybody?
I think I got a call from someone, and they were like, "Just want to let you know we got your CD, and we wanted to say keep trying." That's when I learned how to play guitar, and I started writing my own songs.
There's a little girl in this little town with a little too much heart.
I would find time to write either in class.
Uh-huh.
Oh. Which, you know, when the teachers would conduct random notebook checks, you can imagine their surprise when it's algebra on this side of the page and Drew looks at me on the other side of the page.
Sweet, heartfelt lyrics we see Taylor singing during rehearsals are what first got her noticed by RCA Records, the label behind famous names like Christina Aguilera, Kelly Clarkson, and Dave Matthews. Taylor was only 14.
I played them a few songs and they said that they wanted to sign me to a development deal. A development deal is an in-between record deal.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a guy saying that he wants to date you but not be your boyfriend. They don't want to sign you to an actual record deal and put an album out on you. They want to watch your progress for a year.
But at the end of that year, a major letdown. RCA took a pass on Taylor.
They wanted to shelf me.
Okay, that's a bummer.
Keep me in development till I was probably about 18. So I walked away from the biggest record label in Nashville.
By then, Taylor had convinced her family to move to Nashville, where she kept writing songs and playing wherever she could, still hoping for that one lucky break.
I had this big showcase at the Bluebird Cafe, and all of these record labels showed up. And at the end, this guy named Scott Borchetta came up to me.
I remember sitting there, just kind of, is this gonna hit me? And it absolutely did. And so I went and met with the family after that.
He said, "I have good news and I have bad news." Now, Scott Borchetta worked at Universal Records.
Okay.
And so he goes, "The good news is that I want to sign you to a record deal. The bad news is that I'm no longer with Universal Records."
Oh, no.
And he then explained to me that he wanted to start up his own brand new record label. And that he didn't have a name for it, he didn't have a building for it, he didn't have a staff for it, but he had a dream. And would I go on board? And I went with my gut instinct, which just said, say yes.
That was a giant leap of faith, wasn't it?
There are a million ways it could have gone wrong, yeah. You saw me
there, but never knew. Borchetta called his little record label Big Machine, and within no time, the neophyte record president and his ingenue were on the fast track to music fame.
I think it was in August of 2005. Taylor played me a song called When You Think Tim McGraw.
When you think Tim McGraw, I hope you think my favorite song, the one we dance to all night long.
She finished the song and I said, "Do you realize what you just have written? Do you have any idea?" And that was that moment of, oh my God. And the grenade dropped in the still pond.
Just 3 years later, Taylor's record sales have topped 7 million.